Alright, so I'm doing a video what I think about the Retron 5 after actually using it for quite a few years. I don't even remember how many. I bought one on release, but I fried that one with the wrong power adapter, and then I had to buy a new one. Which, by the way, they should label the back so that you know what power goes here. And if you are in that predicament and you don't have a power adapter, see if we can get this to focus. Right. There it is. Or possibly like this so you can see it better. That's all the information on the proper power adapter, so if you need it, there it is. They sell them on their website. Now focus again. Focus. Okay. So, anyways, so that was a rant on the power adapter. So, had this for quite a few years. Had it in my old house. Used it, loved it. It was great. Never had a problem that I can think of. Let's see. Ended up having to transition to a new place. But for a while, I had to stay with my parents because I had no place to go, and couldn't find a place. And then I finally found one and came here. So this was in storage for a while, and so it was in storage, and what? So it was kind of had stuff on top of it, and it was covered in dust, everything. So it's been through that, and when I got it out, it worked fine. So that's that. So it plays Genesis. Well, actually, soon it's going to be Master System as well. So there's going to be Genesis. I'm sorry, it's does Master System. I meant Game Gear. They have an adapter coming out for Game Gear. So Genesis Master System, it's going to do the cards, and Game Gear. I think the power base converter already does the cards. I don't have a power base converter, but I have a shitty little DIY kind of thing that somebody did. Then I have this SNES port, which also does Super Famicom. Then it has NES and Famicom. And then the Game Boy port in the front, which does Game Boy Color, and Game Boy Advance. And so far, all the games seem to look fine. They play great. The console output's 720p. I have a 4K TV, and it looks great on the 4K TV. Never really had a problem with on two different televisions. Never had a problem with lag. So, yeah, I mean, gotta make sure that when you get your TV that it's got some acceptable input lag and stuff. Although I didn't exactly do that when I recently bought my new TV, but luckily it's fairly low, so it's not a problem. You may have a little issue with the pack-in controller, I don't know, but that thing's a piece of shit, so so what else? Yeah, we got support on here for the Sega Genesis, NES, and Super Nintendo controllers. When it first came out, it actually supported Master System controllers, but they took away the support because apparently it caused some kind of bug, and I don't remember what that was. Unfortunately, it no longer supports Master System controllers. Of course, you can't play light gun games because, well, the lack of the ability to use a CRT television. So it won't support any light gun games. What else? So it has an SD card in the rear. It has the SD card, the HDMI, blah blah blah, USB for charging, and the power. This one is a revision from the first ones that were released. First ones had issues with the card ports. Putting carts in and stuff and taking them out. They had my first one had like it was really it made a grinding noise. It was the games were hard to put in and get out. And this one, they did fix that, as well as this used to be able to be pressed down, and now it's, yeah, it doesn't press down. So they did a few things on it to revise the system. I don't even remember all of it. So, yeah, that's that. And then, what else? So, yeah, you got all your controller support. One thing over the Retro Freak is that you can do two players, and you get you can have two Super Nintendo controllers, and they're built into the console, so they don't require a separate adapter. Of course, the Retro Freak does ROM dumps and stuff, like ones that allow you to save the ROMs and the stuff. So allows anything like that, and you can load ROMs off of SD cards and all that, which you can't do here. Well, you technically can, but there's like a hacky workaround for that, or you can probably root it and do stuff. So this is supposed to be my thoughts. So so far I've been loving it. Love the save states because I don't have a CRT. The original hardware, which I do have, see, it looks like shit on my TV. Looks like total garbage. TV just doesn't scale it well. You see those big borders around the games and all that. And yeah, it kind of looks like ass. Sounds like crap too, because you have those analog cables that give all noise, give off all that noise and crap. Plus, the Retron 5 has enhanced sound, so you can get the really crystal clear sound from it, and it sounds great. This here, the packing controller, is a piece of shit. The only thing I can actually give credit to it for is the button layout. So I'm not talking about these silly designs on here. I don't even know what they were thinking with that. But the button layout works great for all Nintendo and Super Nintendo games. So we could have the six button layout like this for Genesis, and whatever we want, select or a trigger or bumper to be the mode button. Or you can have select, whatever. So it works great for if you, it's a great for a more universal, like a hybrid controller. However, that's it. It's cheap piece of shit. It has this squeaky noise. Sometimes takes a little while to develop. Huh. Yeah, there it is. It does feel kind of cheap. It's got like micro switches and whatever this thing. Well, this is like one of those Neo Geo thumb pad things, which Sega Genesis games didn't really have. There are some games that actually work well with this, and there are some games actually would that work better with that. But there's some games that are just impossible to play with that. And I'd much rather just use the D-pad because it works fine, and that's what it was made for. And yeah, then you have buttons here for like save states and screenshots or whatever, and the home button. For all that stuff, you can use hotkeys on original controllers. Or what I would recommend if you want a wireless controller, which is a really good option, it's a little bit of extra money, but really love this controller because it works. I even use this on my Nvidia Shield TV. There's a hotkey to get it to work on the Retron 5, and then there's just like you hold start to power it on, and it pairs with my Nvidia Shield TV. So I can use it on either one, they don't conflict in any way. This is a great controller. This is the 8-bit dough. It is actually 8-bit dough, like Nintendo. And it is a great controller. It's a wireless Bluetooth controller. The latency is really freaking low, like the same as the Super Nintendo controller. It's been tested. It's basically the same damn shit. It feels exactly like a Super Nintendo controller. It is very sturdy. It doesn't feel like one of those cheap, crappy third-party controllers. I wish there were more third-party controllers like this, especially a Genesis one would be nice too, or a nice wireless Genesis controller. I had Hyperkin's GN6 controller and it broke in like 3 days or something. Piece of junk. So this is the original six button controller is still king there. But this, it's a brand new controller. Nobody spit all over it or, like a 80-year-old woman smoked on top of it and like blew her nose or something on it or whatever. So this is a brand new controller. It's Bluetooth, so it's wireless. It has very low latency. You can also use it wired. You can use it on PC, Android, whatever you want. But it works with the Retron 5 and is the so far the best wireless solution that I've used. They make other controllers that also work with this, including a what do you call it? A fighting stick. So like an arcade stick, you can actually pair it, I believe, with this. And you can play your fighting games and like even Streets of Rage or something on the Retron 5 with a fighting stick, a wireless one. It's a little over 100 bucks or 100 bucks, I don't remember, but it's about on par with the average fighting stick unless you're going to go really cheap. But for a wireless one, it looks really good. So I've seen that and that I want that one of those. It also works with Android and all that stuff. It's the same thing except for in a fighting stick format kind of thing. So this is a great controller and it's great. So get one now. Anyway, so the only thing with this is you do have to, if you're going to play Genesis games, you do have to map it out because it's trying to replicate this controller. And this controller has these two extra buttons here that this doesn't. So it's trying to act like a six button controller, like A, B, where's C? Oh, it's not there. So obviously you need to make up for that by like mapping them to the bumpers and stuff. So that's that. So I would definitely recommend that controller or the original controllers, which you can plug into the system. Or another wired option that I like is. There it is. It's called the friggin' tangled with a million wires. Well, there goes that, and there goes that, and there goes this, and there goes everything. There goes the world. This is, if you can find it, I don't know. This isn't so bad. This is a very sturdy controller. Pro Pad, the SN Pro Pad for SNES with turbo functions and all that crap. This is actually not a bad controller. It's just that it was weird. The cable kept tangling up, and it was annoying. So even though I'm very close to my TV, I wanted something wireless so I didn't have that tangling mess cable that was annoying as hell. Whatever. So now, the thing you may want to know is that even though I don't have it, and I can only go with facts that I've read online, so. Comparing this to something like the analog NT, obviously that's like the more, that's the really hefty kind of very nice quality NES. I believe it does NES and Famicom, really expensive. Although I think the Mini is cheaper, I think it's like 300 bucks, but still, it's still way more expensive than this. I think it's also less powerful. But it has that aluminum case. I don't know, aluminum is not exactly like the top tier metal, but whatever. It is aluminum. But I do believe that aluminum goes for quite a bit if you take it to like a junkyard or whatever the fuck you call it. So it is actually a bit of a sought after metal these days, more than steel. But other than that, it doesn't matter. So, the Retron 5, and you have the analog NT, say. So, the analog T NT, at least the Mini, is attempting to be the actual original hardware. And the Retron 5 is just like an emulation box, so it's got some kind of ARM hardware on board, and it has software that emulates the games and stuff. So the thing is that analog's approach kind of drives up the price. That kind of thing normally drives up the price, where as emulation will normally keep the price lower. So that's one part. Also, the Retron is actually more capable of playing higher end systems than the analog. The analog can only, I believe, play Hello, Coffee Maker. The analog NT can only play like 8-bit systems, and if I'm correct, I don't remember if I heard that, because Tetris is going to be releasing some cores for that. I think we already did a few. You can load ROMs off an SD card, no cartridges, but there's a firmware you can load from the SD card, and it enables more systems to be played. And it's mostly 8-bit systems, but I could have sworn they mentioned a couple, smaller time 16-bit systems that they may be able to get run, to run. And that's all free, which is cool, but yeah, I mean, you did spend more on the system. So for this, so far, if you want to run more games, you're going to need to purchase some adapters and stuff like that. It is possible, apparently, to root the thing because it's an Android device, and you can even play like PlayStation games on it and stuff. So this is more capable of it. Already does 16-bit out of the, on board. It supports 16-bit games. If you were to root it, you could even play PlayStation games and things like that. So it's kind of more, I guess it's more powerful. It's got a Rock chip processor on board. I don't remember exactly which one. So Rock chip normally makes a cheaper kind of decent processors. So you can get a normally a decent deal or with some decently powered but cost efficient type processors. What else can I say about this? It is possible to load ROMs. I don't know if I mentioned that. You can load ROMs, but it's a little finicky if you don't root. You could patch a game to run as a different game. So I really only do that if I can't get the game, or if like the game was only released as a ROM file. So in some cases that doesn't even work. Like I tried playing Boss. What was that, the game? Boss something Gaiden. It was made for the. They have an SNES version and an SNES, like the Nintendo PlayStation, which basically, as far as I'm aware, they've only found one PlayStation, Nintendo PlayStation prototype, but it runs on that, the one PlayStation prototype, and it runs on the Nintendo, and I tried to run the Super Nintendo version. And it gave me a black screen. So I don't know if I accidentally did it wrong or if it, just can't play it. But that game played on the Shield TV. So, and I believe it's using this. Is it using this? Yeah, I think I was using the same emulator this thing has. Because, they did do a bad. No, don't do that again. Yeah, Hyperkin kind of stole something. Yeah, and then they don't want you to steal their, got their protection on here, so you can't steal the games. Meanwhile, they're stealing the software that they put onto it. So yes, they did do that. Me and that was funny because they, I heard some. I was heard some of the developers talk, and they said they would have gladly put their emulators on the machine, but Hyperkin, I guess, failed. To just contact them. All they had to really do was email them and say, "Hey, we're putting together a system. Is it okay if we use your emulators?" And a lot of them said they would say yes, and because they wanted the games, those old games, to be have more, have more options to play those old games and stuff. So, but they didn't contact them and decided to go with the route of stealing something that they would have gotten for free just fine. But whatever. So that's that. And what else? What are we talking about here? Anything else? Oh, I want to get back to talking about the analog NT thing. I don't know why. I don't even know what I'm covering it more on that. Yeah. Okay, so actually, I want to look something up because there is that also the retro USB, which is basically very similar to the analog NT. But I have to share this with you. I love this live wallpaper. It's fucking awesome. That's the best. Anyways, the retro USB, which is a cheaper kind of version of the, I don't want to say the version of the analog NT. I believe, I don't remember. There's a difference other than the build quality and stuff like that. But I think it's totally incapable of playing anything but the games on board, and it could they said like it could just barely play that, like that's all it can play. So that's a little bit different that way. But okay, so honestly, the ABS is only it's $20 more than the Retron 5. Apparently coming down from $185. Now it only plays NES and what was it? NES and Famicom. Which honestly, I don't know. Famicom, whatever. So yeah, it plays NES and Famicom through I believe like that FPGA. I don't know if it's a Kevtris board or what, but it's using kind of that, I believe. I'm not sure. But apparently it's really good. It has a nice HD signal, but it's the price it is because of its hardware. Well, it looks really nice. It looks awesome. It really looks like the NES, kind of what the NES probably should have been like, instead of having that stupid door, because I have an NES and I've had to fix it multiple times. And this looks like it just is exactly what it should have, the NES should have been, except for of course the HDMI wouldn't have worked back then. And like on games probably won't work. I don't know if this has I don't think it has AV out. I don't know. Not sure. But yeah, you can play NES games. The difference is this is cheaper and it will play all these systems. So and it plays it with save states and does all this stuff, and because it's using emulation, it doesn't cost as much as these other systems. So that's that. So if you're not like if you like it, like I love emulation, so I don't have a problem with this thing running through emulation, and I don't mind that because if it's going to keep the cost down, things like that, emulation is just fine. The only difference is it's dumping the ROM from the cart. I never found myself ever thinking about that when I play a game. I just pop the game in, whatever happens, happens, and I don't think about it. I just play the game. So it doesn't bother me. I thought it would, but it doesn't. So that's that. And yeah, so that, of course, that's another option. I like all the options, though. I like all the options available for people that want to play physical carts, so that you don't just only have the ability to just download ROMs off the internet and play them on your television. You can also use cartridges. So whether you have a collection and you don't really give a crap about people playing ROMs or whatever, if you're not concerned with that, but you have a collection you want to play it, you can. Or if you're like, oh God, emulation is evil, maybe this could something like this could get those people to try out some emulation because they know that it's legal, and that well, maybe what Hyperkin wasn't did. I don't know that it was illegal, but I don't know that it wasn't. I don't know anything. But besides that, if you put your carts in and everything, and you're concerned about legalities, you should be okay. You will be okay. Yeah, so there shouldn't be a problem there. And then you can learn what's so great about emulation that you missed because you were like screaming about how emulation was illegal and stuff, and you didn't realize that there's more to it than just getting free games that normally just run, a lot of them just run you like 99 cents. I've got quite a few for free, so the games being free does not do anything for me that much, because having a game that's 99 cents or sometimes even 50 cents, it's kind of whatever. I mean, on eBay it's more expensive, but I used to be able to get games for like nothing, and sometimes even nothing for free. So for me, I love emulation because of things like save states, because of the graphics being cleaner without needs for mods and just stuff like that. I love, and being able to put the cartridges in and play them through emulation to me is like great. I love that. Being able to play your games that you couldn't play through all the way, because if you shut the system off, you were done and had to start all over again. That sucked. Now you don't have to do that. It remembers exactly where you left off. So it remembers in each individual cartridge where you left off. So you can play through all those games that you were struggling to beat because of the lack of a save system. Or if you have a game that has a dead battery, you can use the save states instead. Or the snapshot feature where you, like I said, you turn off your game and it remembers exactly where you were, so you don't have to worry about it. So, yeah, and then a lot of other cool things. Being able to use things you normally had to pay extra for free, like the built-in Game Genie. And you don't have to put in any codes. You just download the Game Genie file thing, you put it on the SD card, and then all those Game Genie cheats are on there, and you don't have to buy a Game Genie. And you can easily load the cheats up. There's a simple list with all these cheats, and you just easily load them up. You don't have to look them up in a book or online or any of that. You just grab the cheat, you load it up. The patch files are really cool, so you have games. There was games in some situations where when they came out, I thought they sucked. And there were ports of games like Mortal Kombat 2 that on the Genesis I thought was garbage when it came out, but I played it, of course, because I was a big Mortal Kombat fan, and I was like, it didn't matter what the game was like, I was going to play it. But if you apply the Mortal Kombat 2 Unlimited patch to that, if that was if it was even close to that when it was launched, I would have been shitting my pants for how good it was. But it wasn't. That wasn't it. But you could play that, and that's actually fun. So that's cool and all that. And of course, you save a lot of space. You don't have to have a million consoles everywhere with wires hanging out all over the place. So, I love all the benefits of emulation and free games. That means not much to me. I mean, the only way it really benefits me is if the game's really expensive. Game's ridiculously expensive. That's one thing. So, and like I said, I like the idea that I like the fact that they're coming out with all these options. Another one, the retro blocks, I've been interested in, but I'm a little concerned about certain things. But it's not, I'm not worried about actually who was that? I got Mike Kennedy. I'm not, I don't think that that's going to be the case technically. And this guy hasn't really done anything wrong, so I'm not going to go incriminating him to do terrible things. But I just had problems with Kickstarter. Not really problems with Kickstarter, I just see too many projects that I'm interested in go belly up because the people misuse the money, and then they don't produce a product, and they just take everyone's money and you're fucked. So I've seen too much of that, even though I understand the benefit of the site, the possible benefit, but I don't want to give somebody my money and have them run away with it. So, but I hope they do get funded, and I hope it goes well. And I like the idea of the PlayStation support. So here's, I'm going to be showing how the carts go in and out. Very simple. So we're just going to try the game. Game Boy game. Here's a repro, Sega Genesis. And so it's very simple. Just comes out. No grinding noises like in the first one. This one, this game, I would recommend do not get this. DROM is online if you search. It takes a little while to find it. I have a video where I show a link to this ROM, because I don't think anyone should pay the asking price for this low quality cartridge with a label that doesn't really fit on here, that was falling off when I got it. It's still kind of healing up a bit, and the thing is really low quality. Anyways, but it's a Pico Interactive Sega Genesis game. Way too much money, and it is really hard to get into any system. This is actually easier to get into the Retron 5 than it is the Genesis. So, Sega Genesis, and let's see if I can... I think I kind of exaggerated it via the placebo effect there, but let me... It's a little better now, but before it was kind of grinding in there, but it's probably because I separated the pins with this cart. It's really thick. Let's see if we can get a Sega Genesis game that's unreal from the times. You see how thin that is compared to, oh god, this. That's a lot. It's, if I can actually get the lighting on there. But yeah, this card here is a lot thicker than this. And it's harder to get in normally. I'm going to just put a regular Sega Genesis game in here. And that was really painless. So, that would be the Sega Genesis area. And the Game Boy. Here's a Super Famicom game. The only censored version for this for Nintendo's system at the time, their 16-bit system. Only censored version of Mortal Kombat 2. That's why I bought it. I don't know why. Because I'm a big Mortal Kombat fan. And it really goes in, you don't even notice it. It almost has no, just goes right in, and then you start pushing more because you think it couldn't have already gone in. There's a little squeakiness in there though. Let's see about a regular Super Nintendo. It's kind of the same, but different shape. I don't know. Very easy. Actually, put these back. And then we go with a Nintendo game. Mike Tyson's Punch Out. What did I do there? I didn't put it in correct. Oh, I put it in the Famicom slot. Ooh. Okay, so. Alright. So, you know, all the carts and then the newer revision, they're fine. I don't have a problem with them coming in and going out. The good thing about the Nintendo slot is it's not going to fail on you like the other one did. They don't have those region chips and all this other crap and failing 72-pin connector issues, which had a major issue with my NES with that. So that's a really cool thing that you don't have to worry about that. And you can use a really good wireless SNES pad with this. It's great to lean back and not have the wires tangle up and then yank the console.